What I'd like to do with a few minutes I have is to talk about meeting the grand challenges in musculoskeletal diseases. And at first I was going to sort of talk about what the grand challenges were and the different diseases, and then I had all these slides, and about 200 slides, and I was told my talk had to be about 10 minutes. So, of course, what I decided to do is to talk a little bit about what we're doing and how we're thinking about and what we think about in general in terms of what it, as a paradigm for what it takes to start to look at the grand challenges. So to meet the grand challenges, we need three things. I think we need bold ideas, we need bold, smart people, and we need organizations that believe in us and believe in funding ideas that are bold and people who are bold and smart. And our work has involved musculoskeletal injuries and treatment of musculoskeletal injuries. And we know the information. There are over 28 million musculoskeletal injuries annually. One in every seven Americans reports it. Societal costs are $250 billion annually. And the bold idea that was that came out in the late 1980s was tissue engineering. And tissue engineering can be defined as the application of biological, chemical, and engineering principles toward the repair, restoration, or regeneration of living tissues using biomaterial cells and factors alone or in combination. And from this classic paper in science on tissue engineering by Bob Langer, who we're all children of. I'm his child, and Helen's his grandchild. Who actually started the field. The classic paradigm is to have a matrix or scaffold, add cells, biological factors to be able to implant and regenerate different areas. And this was a bold idea in those days. And I remember when submitting my first grant about engineering new bone, in which it was recently discovered how to really cultivate human osteoblasts on tissue culture polystyrene. And I remember submitting my first grant application saying that we'll be able to regenerate bone using degradable polymers. And, you know, there's a lot of skepticism because they just learned how to be able to grow bone cells on tissue culture polystyrene. But it was an idea whose time has come. In our group, we've thought about what the next generation of what we should be thinking about in terms of tissue engineering. And we coined the term regenerative engineering, which is the integration of tissue engineering with some of the advances that have taken place in the last 10 years. And those are advances in material science, advances in stem cell science, and also advances in developmental biology toward the regeneration of complex tissues and organs and organ systems. And we focused on areas such as nanotechnology, nanotechnology-based systems, integration and response of stem cells to biomaterials, and also understanding regenerative biology and regenerative biology influences that are there. Let me just give a couple of examples in terms of these different areas. So in the nanoscale services, we know that cells are accustomed to interact with nanotopography and they influence initial cellular events. And we've had a few papers looking at initial cellular events that takes place at the cell materials interface with nanomaterials. We've been able to create nanofibers, and these mimic the structure of ECM. They're dynamically adjustable. And we found that we can have better cell organization around nanofibers. And this is some data on human skin fibroblast proliferation. And, you know, in the before world, cells just grew on surfaces and we just measure them. But now we know that in this nano-level regime, there's actually differential effects in terms of cell growth. And so this is looking at cell count with different nanofiber materials that have different sizes of the nanofibers. And what we can find is that those nanofibers with different diameters actually have a different level of proliferation of the cells based upon the levels of the nanometer level of fibers. Now again, we used to look at cell growth on surfaces, not really look at the nano regime, nano levels, but we now can see that we can modulate growth based upon the nanofiber diameter of these different materials. So we've created these materials, and we can create these nanofiber matrices that can be fairly durable, that can create materials that we can utilize for skin regeneration. And the next area is in terms of the response of stem cells to biomaterials. And we've gained a lot of information about stem cells in terms of being able to utilize stem cells. we focused on human adipose-derived stem cells. And again, this was work that was funded by NIAMS early on when we first, you know, proposed to use human adipose cells. And there was a lot of skepticism about using adipose cells in terms of being able to derive stem cells from them. But we were, you know, very happily that we were funded to be able to work in the area. We chose human adipose stem cells because, let's face it, how many people have fat on them? Lots. How many people don't need it? Lots. So it's something you have, you don't need, and it's a good thing to be able to use and regenerate to be able to be able to use the work. So we were funded early on in this, you know, to be able to look at ways to be able to cultivate human and derive and cultivate human adipose derived stem cells. And we can now take these stem cells through a number of different pathways. Obviously, we can have them proliferate in terms of in a fibroblast type way, but we can also move them down the lineage toward toward cartilage, and also a lineage down toward bone. And this is actually showing mineralization of these materials. And so, with utilizing the technology that we have with human adipose derived stem cells, adult stem cells, we're able to create a number of musculoskeletal tissues using these materials. And the third area that we're exploring as a part of this is looking at how we actually engineer tissues. Now, the way we think about engineering tissues is usually a top-down approach because we're engineers. We examine larger structures. We try to understand it. We try to mimic its effects. And the classic way is scaffold-based tissue engineering, which is the backbone of how we try to engineer tissues. And if we look at native tissue on one hand, and this is actually looks like native tissue, but it's actually our nanofiber matrix with cells on the artificial matrix. And so this is a technology that's highly practical for regenerating tissue. But there's also another way, and the other way is a bottom-up approach. And this is assembling tissues from the cellular scale to produce intact tissue structures. And the example of that is the blastema. And as we know, a newt can regenerate an entire limb within 7 to 10 weeks. And of course, if you do the experiment, take the limb off, 7 to 10 weeks, it regenerates. And while we're not newts, I have a series of talks that I give that actually demonstrates how we have newt-like qualities. For instance, if a young child has a thumb that's actually cut off, one can use dressing changes and regenerate the the tip of the thumb. And so we're now looking at ways to utilize some of the more primordial factors that are involved in terms of regeneration and regenerative biology, and are incorporating them into our work in terms of engineering tissues. We're looking at the Wnt signaling pathway in terms of the possibility of being able to harness that for bone regeneration. And again, believe that the future is going to involve combining regenerative biology with areas involving involving stem cell science and nanotechnology, along with traditional areas of tissue engineering to move forward. So these are the translational challenges on this side are many, but I believe in terms of moving forward, this needs to be a part of the arsenal. Well, what are we doing now in terms of being able to practically regenerate different types of tissues that we need to move forward? And as you know, I'm an orthopedic surgeon and an engineer and a sports medicine physician, and a lot of the focus we've had is in the ACL. It's a major interarticular ligament of the knee, controls motion, acts as a stabilizer, and ACL injuries lead to excessive joint mobility and instability. And we started, and I'm going to summarize about 15 years of work, a number of postdoctoral fellowships and grad students. And one of the real leaders in terms of moving this forward was actually Helen Liu and her work. And in fact, she arrived the first day when we actually got the grant from NIAMS to fund our ACL work. We've designed a bone, tendon bone type of ligament to regenerate the area, to regenerate the ACL. We've done it by studying in a hierarchical fashion, studying the materials, mimicking it, and then trying to reproduce the material. We created a model for ACL regeneration in the rabbit and implanted in the rabbit. And this is how it looks actually after a period of 3 months in the rabbit. You have a glistening ACL that's there in the rabbit. Interestingly enough, during the time in which the rabbits have the ACL implanted, they actually are moving around very, very well, and it's difficult to control motion right afterwards in terms of their physical therapy regimen as they're rabbits, but moving quite well. And this is what it looks like after 12 weeks. And this is the peripheral region in which we see, we have the polymer fibers, the white areas that are moving, you can see moving toward you, and surrounded in the central region by rich areas of matrix. And then we can also see blood vessels that are present with erythrocytes in the area. And so with those promising studies, and this was published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences, we moved on to a larger model, a sheep model, where we've actually performed the ACL regeneration with a larger ACL in the sheep. And this is the ligament at 12 weeks. And this is the intra-articular area. And again, we get a glistening ligament with areas of vascularization on the outer portions of the material. This is how it looks in terms of the histology. This is actually in the bone itself. We have a screw. We have our ligament that's well opposed with bony ingrowth. And this is the tissue, and it's in the intra-articular zone with evidence of fibroblastic tissue that's present. And this is our sheep study at 6 months, which we've just completed, in which we have, a regenerated ACL and a functional ACL using our synthetic polymeric materials. And again, that's a bold idea that we can regenerate an ACL using synthetic polymeric materials alone without biological factors, just by engineering the matrix in a certain way. And this is a technology that was funded by NIAMS, embraced by NIAMS at an early point in terms of our work. We've also focused on regenerating bone and creating a porous matrix that we can actually place in bone and have it regenerate. And we've created these sintered scaffolds using microsphere matrices, microspheres that are sintered together to create this three-dimensional matrix. And we've used the classic engineering method where we've actually taken our biodegradable scaffold. In this case, again, with our results from stem cell technology, we've actually utilized stem cells along with bioactive factors such as BMPs, combined them together to be able to regenerate. In this case, we create a ulnar defect in the rabbit. We're implanting our matrix with our stem cells in the area. And these are our results just at 8 weeks, where we have our microspheres that are here. But you can see we have really robust bone formation around the area of the microspheres. This is actually deep within the matrix, really regenerating the matrix. Now, the defect site that we use is what's called a critical size defect, meaning that it will not heal naturally without any intervention. And we can get great regeneration of bone in that area. And so this has now inspired a product called Microfuse, which is a bone void filler for regeneration. And it's sort of one of the nice things to sort of see in terms of bench to bedside is the work that's taken place in the laboratory over the number of years. It's actually now translating to materials that are actually being used to help people. So we've now created these different tissue engineered scaffolds. We've talked about the scaffold matrix that we have for bone. For ligament, we have our ligamentous LC ligament scaffold. We've also worked in terms of nerve and blood vessel that we've used our nanofiber matrices to be able to create those. And for cartilage, we have actually our cartilage matrix made of nanofibers, and also we've talked about how we can create these matrices for skin. And so, and also for cartilage. And so with these different types, our approach has been to utilize these different components, and now we're combining these components and to integrate them together to be able to regenerate tissues. And the goal is to regenerate larger areas of tissues, such as whole limbs. So that's the bold idea that's been there. And it's been a series of bold ideas funded by NIAMS, essentially funded by NIAMS over the last 20 years that have brought us to where we are now. So our new area is regenerative engineering. It's tissue engineering, our advances in material science, stem cells biology, and also developmental biology. I believe it's a combination for us to be able to use in the future. Now, the other area is the people side. And as I said, people who are bold and smart and bringing them to the fore. And part of what NIAMS has done in funding research and funding these areas is actually bringing people together and allowing different groups of scientists to come together to be able to work together in an interdisciplinary way. This is my group. This is a group back in the 1990s at Drexel University. And as you can see, here's Helen Liu up front. But you can also recognize a number of the other individuals who are in the audit in this group, and they are now many of them are now NIAMS funded investigators who are working on the research projects of their own in terms of their own group. And here's a group at the University of Virginia with a number of the grad students and fellows, but also young faculty members who are uh, who are here. And that's a, I think that there's a, the Institute has had a special role in terms of cultivating and developing scientists, young scientists, that have gone on to, I think, do really great things. And I think that's a very, very important and perhaps less recognized aspect of what NIAMS has done in terms of for the field. This is actually me at the White House in 2009, and I was very, very honored to receive the Presidential Award of Excellence for mentoring at the White House. And when I sat back and reflected about this, I actually reflected about on NIH and NIAMS and how they have my research experience and my funding and my ability to bring together scientists, young people from a number of different backgrounds to work on research has allowed me to be able to work on my passion, which is not only the science side but also the mentoring side. And this is the current group, and the current group is a fantastic group. It includes Lakshmi Nair, who has an RO3, I think, that's pending at NIAMS. And the rest of my group, that is a fantastic group of scientists who are, and Lakshmi Nair is a fantastic scientist, fantastic group of scientists who are really poised to continue to do great things. And again, it's a very important part. And finally, I just want to, I want to thank NIAMS. This did not come out as well as I thought, but I have a listing that actually, I guess, goes down to the next page, and that's of the funding of NIAMS, and I've been fortunate to be continuously funded by NIAMS for the past 20 years. And then our work in terms of adipose-based tissue engineering that NIAMS saw fit the funding. Broadening the field with a musculoskeletal tissue regeneration T32 grant, and then work in terms of vascularized bone grafts, and that was work with Ed Boachway. And our latest grants, which are not really shown here, in terms of our polymer ceramic systems for engineering more complex tissues that are there. And so I've been very, very grateful for the continuous funding and for the belief that NIAMS has had in terms of exploring these new areas. And I believe that NIAMS is an organization that believes, an organization that is forward-thinking and is bringing about some great science. And so it's particularly an honor for me to be here today to address you. Thank you.